Good morning, everybody. Joel Colander here at Rock Island Auction Company. And I just want to say right off the bat that you're my type of people because it's this early in the morning and you're already watching videos about guns. So kudos to you. I'm here with old Saint Nick, who's looking pretty kitted out at the moment with some bandoliers and some ammo cans, and maybe he's delivering some to you. And well, that might explain the shortage in the meantime. Old Saint Nick, of course, has made an upgrade to old Rudolph here too. Looks like with a Colt Model 1883 Gatling gun, probably avoids a lot more traffic this way than with a glowing red nose. But I jest, of course. This is just here in our auction lobby. It's a little emptier than we normally have it, thanks to our COVID restrictions placed upon by the state of Illinois. But it is still preview day. I've said it once, I've said it 100 times. Preview day is my favorite day. We get to go around in this preview hall and we're gonna show you a whole bunch of guns. And I know a lot of you can't be here, whether it's your state restriction, whether it's just for your own health and safety, a lot of you can't be here. So we're gonna do the best we can to show you the preview hall for what we are calling the sale of the century. That is not hyperbole, it is not exaggeration, it's the sale of the century. And as we go around, I'll start to explain that. When you see some of the guns, you'll be able to see it for yourself. So let's walk through our little auction lobby. Typically, this is where we'd serve our free will donation lunch. And maybe a donut, maybe a Bloody Mary in the morning, maybe a mimosa, play your cards right. And into the preview hall. This is not your ordinary gun auction. This is not your ordinary gun show, in case you couldn't tell. These are items not just on display. As I like to say, these are items that are on exhibit. We really want to provide a context, a sign, a something, a display, even a little information here, so you know what you're looking at, so you can be as taken with them as you should be, so once you know the historical context or just how significant some of these pieces are. So this is all, of course, for the sale of the century. This is our December 2020 premier firearms auction. That's December 4th, 5th, and 6th, with a preview day on December 3rd, which is today. All of which are still open to the public. However, because of the COVID restrictions, we're limited to 25% capacity. So please, if you do plan on coming, give us a call. We want to make sure we have room for you. There might be plenty of room, but just give us a call and let us plan on you being here. So let's talk about some of the guns. Let's talk about the good stuff. Let's just get right into it. These are what we call our horseshoes. And they are some of the featured items of each day. Here on day one, boy, doozies right off the bat. Of course, we got Smith & Wesson's from the Gerald Class collection. I see some that are in our top 10 videos already. So if you haven't seen those yet, make sure you click on a link or check out some of the other videos that we have up underneath it. A pair of beautiful Smith & Wesson's gold inlaid engraved to Olympian Walter Winans. There's a picture of him back there. Fascinating Olympian in the early 20th century. He was a horse rider, but he won his Olympic medals for shooting, like a running deer event. Now, it wasn't a real deer. It was a paper target deer that they'd run across at a distance. And for sculpting. That was when some of the artistic events were still in the Olympics. Very, very cool. And underneath, down on the bottom, I'd be remiss if I didn't show these to you. Some of my favorites. Now, of course, we got Elvis Presley revolver. His Smith & Wesson, this is Model 36, 38 Special. We do have a video of us going out and shooting this in a way that would make Elvis proud. If you haven't seen that yet, make sure you find it. And right next to it, here's one that speaks to my heart. It's a Smith & Wesson registered Magnum. Now, of course, those are the first 357 Magnum production guns ever made. This one, as you can see, comes with its beautiful blue box. They're not often nickel-plated. And this one also comes with the shortest possible barrel that was offered by the factory at this time. Because you could order them with special barrel with your finish and sights, and they were basically a custom order guns. This one with the shortest possible barrel and the nickel finish. That's a very, very cool gun. If you're into Confederate arms, you'll see a number of those as we're going around, engraved Confederate sharps. Obviously, the Confederacy was spending more of their efforts in producing guns than they were engraving them. So when you see a Confederate gun in general, it's going to be very, very rare. When you see a engraved Confederate gun, boy, you're at another level. You've reached another level of collectible firearms. Just looking around, here's a fun little curio. Henry Harrington, it's a 7-shot volley pistol. So if you look actually at the front of the pistol, it has seven barrels, I guess, down at the muzzle end here. And if you look in the case, it's actually a breech loader that you drop in seven shots at once. You can kind of see those blocks. They almost remind me of a 10/22 magazine. Obviously not rotary, but you can drop those in all at once to get your seven shots. So it's just a fascinating curio. Right above it, we have some beautiful lever action pistols. Looks like from Volcanic, New Haven Arms, and Smith & Wesson. And of course, they're just gold inlaid. This just screams Gerald class, most of them. This Volcanic is in beautiful condition. I'm just looking at that wood. I'd be proud to have wood like that on a gun that I own today. Now, the sporting arms sometimes take a back seat to the Colts and the Smith & Wessons and the Winchesters, but my goodness, the sporting arms in this sale, there are just tables and tables of beautiful sporting arms. This happens to be an engraved pair of Joseph Harkin & Son. These are 12 bore, and I'm not gonna go into a whole lot. Now, you have, of course, they're double case, so you have two layers in the case of the gun, not only for the guns, but the accessories as well. I'm gonna pick this one up just to show you the butt plate and show you the condition on these things. Look at the bluing and how mirrored that is on that butt plate, which is of course engraved by there, you know, the screws, the tang that comes up here on the buttstock, all engraved. And that Damascus pattern on the barrels is really fine. All right, I said I wasn't gonna go into it. I just wanted to show you the butt plate because I walked past that and was just, oh my gracious sakes. That is a beautiful, beautiful shotgun. This one of Granville Stuart, if you've been paying attention to our blogs and YouTube channels, boy, you've seen these. They have gotten a whole mess of coverage, and rightfully so. So I won't go into it too much. If you haven't seen those videos yet, you really need to. We have, of course, a 1 of 1,000 Winchester Model 1873. That's the one in front there with Granville Stuart's name. Comes with the communications he made between him and Winchester are very documented. When Granville Stuart documented a lot of his life and a lot of Montana, so it's no surprise that perhaps we have those records. It's always a nice surprise to have those records, but to have his communications when he ordered this gun, when he received this gun, is very cool. And of course, right above it, a big old Winchester 1876, which he calls in one of those letters that we mentioned, the quote, boss game gun of all creation. Now, if that's not a title, I don't know what is, but he basically custom ordered every single portion of this gun, including the engravings on there, which he sent sketches to Winchester. and he even told them where to put it, and they nailed it. They just nailed it right out of the park. Let's flip around to the other side, and we can see of this Granville Stuart exhibit, we get another figure of American history, Little Miss Sure Shot herself, Annie Oakley. And any auction, I'd be lucky to have one firearm of Annie Oakley's. Here in this case, there are three firearms of Annie Oakley's. Of course, the beautiful, the Smith & Wesson 2232 hand ejector. We have a Remington Model 12B, that's a gallery gun special. And of course, that gold, beautiful case, hardened, factory engraved, Marlin, just an absolute beauty. Now, a year ago, we had the pleasure of offering a gilt Marlin, and that sold for $575,000. This one happens to be, you know, it's a takedown. This one's a model 1893, so slightly earlier model, but just as beautiful. Even without the Annie Oakley history, you're looking at a premier collectible with the Annie Oakley history. Again, why it's in the sale of the century. It's you're starting to see how this goes. Now, I hate to say it, but we walked past three Tiffany & Company Smith & Wessons. That's another gun like Annie Oakley where any auction would be lucky, ourselves included, would be lucky to have just one. I mean, the Metropolitan Museum of Art houses them. In fact, the Metropolitan Museum of Art houses some of the Tiffany Smith & Wessons from the same collection, the Gerald Class collection, some of which he has put on the public market. We have some of them, as you've seen probably in our last few auctions, we've had quite a few. We've had some in our other two premier auctions this year. They can't go on forever. There is a limited supply. These are gonna dry up. If you do need some of the best are in the sale of the century. Let's take a look at the rest of day one. We could probably fill this video with 1911s alone and US military items. Here's just a few. North American Arms 1911, literally the rarest of the 1911s, maybe 100 produced, probably 104, I think they said. This one happens to be serial number one. Mind-blowing, sale of the century. Here we have serial number 1911, serial number 22. That's day one production, and it is beautiful. You can still catch kind of those niter blue parts on the trigger, slide release, safety, hammer, etc., etc. And behind it, this is the Colt Special Army serial number 9. And if you're familiar with the development of the 1911, you know how special those first few are and their involvement in the trials. Here is serial number 9. Did I mention I love my job? It's a lot of fun, but let's dig right down into it. And here's a gun that, if you like to read some gun books, here's one you'll be familiar with. This is called the Maximilian Carbine. Now, this is a Winchester 1866, thought to be originally presented, or at least purchased, for Emperor Maximilian I of Mexico. Obviously, when you see later on the case, it was taken from the collection, or was in the collection later, of the president, Porfirio Diaz. And as you can see also, it is a striking Winchester, similar to some other presentation Winchesters at that time. Note the antique ivory stock. We have the Mexican eagle with the snake and the cactus carved into the stock. This incredible, incredible engraving on a receiver that still shows traces of an original silver-plated finish. And you notice it is a carbine with the barrel bands and lack of fore-end cap. So very much of the times, very much of the fighting that was taking place in the Southwest United States and of course in Mexico at that time when they were still establishing their country. Let's come around to, and you probably saw it when we were talking about the different days, but no less than Teddy Roosevelt, the Bull Moose Colt Single Action. This is Colt Single Action Army presented to Teddy Roosevelt himself. Now you look and you can kind of see some of the trademarks. We got this, that checkerboard engraving just forward of the cylinder on the receiver. And that should tell us, oh, we got a Kuno Helfrich engraved revolver on our hand. So you love to see Kuno Helfrich's work. Probably not as talked about as some of the others, you know, the Ulrichs, the Nimschke's, but just top-notch engraving and deluxe. You look at that barrel. It's not just down at the muzzle and close to the cylinder. It is the whole barrel. This has been silver plated. You got the carved steer head grips. Now this was given to Teddy Roosevelt for his 54th birthday. And if that wasn't cool enough, like a birthday gift to Teddy Roosevelt, and it's a silver plated Helfrich engraved Colt, it was given to him just days before he was shot. There was, if you haven't heard, there was an assassination attempt on Theodore Roosevelt's life before he was to give a speech, or while he was giving a speech, even my recollection is a little fuzzy on it, he was shot. His speech in his pocket deflected the bullet or patted it a little bit, and he went on and gave the speech. He even apologized in the speech for having been shot, and so you'd have to bear with him a little bit. The politician of a different age, and a gun, a Colt of a different age as well. Might be one of my favorite guns of the sale, but that might just also be because I really, really like Teddy Roosevelt. So coming behind us here, when I mentioned there were enough 1911s to do kind of this talk around every single day, boy, case in point. Here's a 1912, so very, very, very early production. Again, those niter blue parts. This one, very cool. It comes with its original box and the ordnance bill of sale. I don't know about you guys, but I love to see that stuff. I love to see capture papers, those period documents that come with it. Just incredible. And of course, the condition. The condition on the 1912 Navy contract in front of it is even more stunning. Now, it's almost right under this light, and you can see how inky black that finish is. It's, I mean, you got to look pretty hard to find some scuffs and scrapes on that one. On the other side, of course, we have a first-year government model, just as inky black as the first, and those niter blue parts are screaming. A 1903 pocket hammer behind it. And here in our day two horseshoe behind us, I mean, it's just same tale. Here, they varied it up a little bit. We have a beautiful Savage 1907 for the trials. So here, you know, in 45, not your usual smaller calibers that you expect to see the Savage in. How about a three-digit government? How about a beautiful Super 38? How about a Russian contract 1911? How about a World War I Marine Corps? How about a 3-digit serial number for a U.S. contract? Like it just keeps going. Here's a 1902 Sporting. Here's a 1900 Site Safety. Like it just doesn't stop. So if you're a U.S. military collector, if you're a 1911 collector, congratulations. Like this weekend, you hit a jackpot. Coming around, we have some more Civil War revolvers. Let's see, there were some. And beautiful. I hate to pass by them and give them short trips, especially when they're cased, when they're two tones, like silver and gold plated 1851 Navy. But friends, we got a lot to show you. Especially now, if you've seen the last few, we've had a Mercedes Gullwing in the auction hall. This auction hall sale of the century is a little different. I'd like to introduce you to my boyhood dream car, Lamborghini Countach, with that big single windshield wiper and its stealth bomber looks, and black outside, white on the inside. Oh man, there's a reason this is my dream car. These are just slick. Look, it's like a spaceship just ready to launch. What a Lambo. All right, back to guns. Let's take a look at some of the high art pistols over here. Now, a lot of these, actually, I'll just point them out because you guys have seen them already on some of our other videos. Some Gastein Renettes with some huge mounts on them and silver mounts on there, which blend perfectly with those carved stocks. Like the whole stock, it almost looks wrinkled with engraving and sculpture. Like it's absolutely phenomenal. Of course, you see the ends of the muzzles here, towards the barrels. It almost looks like columns you would see in architecture, but still with some little silver floral additions on the end. Here on the right, a pair of Charles Lancaster Howda pistols, gold, beautiful, definitely for some close quarters, made for the Maharaja of Jodhpur, as you will see with several of the big boars that we have here in this sale. And boy, yeah, if there was a tiger that was going to attack my Howda, I would definitely want a pair of those with me. To our right, more Charles Lancaster Gold Guild. Again, there's a video on this as well, and with good reason. And if you know Charles Lancaster, you know that they're known for 4-barrel long arms. This happens to be one of them. An interesting set with 2 actions, but not 2 sets of barrels. No, one of the barrels was not lost to time. We do have the case, and that's the full case. It came with 2 stocks. And 2 stocks, 2 actions, and 1 quad set of barrels. Here we have some military swords, and I will just point out the one that went to Lieutenant Charles McNally. We also have a full video on this guy. That's lot 1151 in the catalog. Beautiful, simple man, Irish immigrant, started making his fortune, and then he fought for the United States. And boy, did he fight for the United States. He paid pretty hefty cost physically. He sacrificed a great deal for this country. Oh, here we have some of the class 3 goodies. Now, not all of them are out on the table. We do keep those locked up, and we are here before most other folks. But anytime you can see a tank Gewehr sitting around and you realize just how large those were, some of those first, what we now consider primitive anti-tank weapons, but essentially was what we use today. We use a little light artillery. Well, maybe not today, because now there's bazookas and rockets. Here's one we did not do a video on, is Japanese Type 5. That is the Japanese copy of the M1 Garand. As you can see, we have some original capture certificate with it and the case that he used to ship it home. How cool is that? I love it. It's like it dropped right out of the 1940s and into your lap. And a beautiful gun, a beautiful version of a very, very rare World War II rifle. Let's keep working our way around this Day 2 horseshoe. Of course, the Walther WA-2000, the Wazoo, as some people call it, colloquially. And what a beautiful, beautiful piece. We do have a feature video on that as well. We'll try to throw up some links. And right next to it, it's a superb gun of one era. And here's 2 superb guns of another. And they are just about 2 minty Winchesters as you could hope to find. I don't even like that word. I don't like minty, but this though. Jewish priest, I think they qualify. You check out the loading gate on the 73, like what's it been loaded a handful of times? Shotgun butt, pistol grip, checker front, beautiful case hardening, full octagon. She's a beaut, Clark, as they say. When we talk about some of the sporting arms, we're gonna move into Day 3 now. So here we've passed sort of that plane into Day 3. The elephant in the room again. We have some more more of these extravagant Lancasters. And here you notice the gold finish, the engraving, sort of a similar motif. Well, that would make sense since it's a similar motif for the same person, the Maharaja of Jodhpur. These are a pair of 8-bore big game rifles, so very appropriate to have next to the elephant. We can't cover all of them, but one more that I did want to cover over here, kind of away from the big game rifles, we have a presentation hall rifle. We do have a special video on this. One of the only rifles ever presented by Congress. It was a group of 17 rifles. It's the only time they've ever presented rifles. And it took them a while because it wasn't, of course, an act of Congress. But a very technologically advanced, they weren't just presenting, you know, junk rifles to people. These were pretty top of the line rifles. Yes, despite being a flintlock and being presented in the early 1800s, that was quite a gift to be presented, and rightfully so, for some soldiers' acts in the siege of Plattsburgh during the War of 1812. Anyway, you want the full story, you'll have to watch the video on that. Next, we got an L.D. Nimshki piece. L.D. Nimshki's magnum opus, arguably his finest work, and it is phenomenal. Now, this is presented, believed to have been presented, pardon me, to Confederate General P.G.T. Beauregard. Don't ask me to recite all the name. Let's just call him Pierre. Can we just call him Pierre? Pierre Beauregard. And it is fantastic. You can see his picture in gold right there where the barrel starts, right next to the wedge. And what work, what engraving, how small it is, how precise, those gold inlaid lines. Now this actually will have featured in a blog, so if you want to know some of the theories that are evolving about, you know, maybe who did the gold engraving, the portrait work, because that was not Nimshki's strongest suit typically, so there are theories that he may not have done that, but if it is Nimshki's, in fact it may have been Gustav Jung who came in and did the portraiture, but if it is Nimshki's work, then it's unquestionably his finest work. As it is, it's very close to his top, if not his top, some of his top work. But with the portrait, it would be far and away something that he put in more effort to than anything. It is a step above and beyond. More 1911s, what can I say? And look, oh, we've had some folks previewing the case set of bouteilles out and just ready to look at. And it's a beautiful sort of hatched checkering here and the suite of accessories. Underneath, more 1911s. There's 1911 and 455 Webley. Sorry, one's just happens to be a beautiful 1905, but placed very appropriately. But there's early Colt 1911s, Union switch and signals, another 1912 Navy. Not quite as pristine as the other one, so maybe if you're not, you know, if you still want a 1912 production U.S. Navy contract, maybe you get outbid for the top condition one. Here's this one sitting here on day three to give you a second chance. And boy, what a second chance. Now here's one of a couple items in the auction that actually have never been opened. One is actually a Beretta M9 from the Alan Coors collection. It's on day two, still in its original bag, sealed, never been opened. We have big signs on it, please don't open this. Here's another one, says, do not open. It's an unopened US Atlantic Escape and Evasion barter kit. You might find some coins in there. You might find some other things that you could use to barter and escape. And that one, never been opened. So if you come here, like I said, we are open to the public. Yeah, you know, just don't open it. Oh, but right next to that, how about our Singer, 1911, and a beautiful one at that. Right above that, actually two above that, there's a beautiful engraved Smith & Wesson number one. You know, it's the number one with that bag handle. And look at all the original finish on this. I mean, you're talking from the mid 19th century, factory engraved, and look at all that original bluing. Just, it's kind of staggering. You're starting to see why this is a sale of the century. One of the two Colt Pattersons in the sale. This one happens to be a number three belt model. You can see it's got that beautiful flared grip. I'm gonna have our camera guy come up top here and you can see all the blue that's on that back strap. Look at how deep it is. Look at how, you know, for something, that's the place you're gonna grab every single time. And it still has all that bluing on there. Of course, comes with its case, comes with its charger, comes with spare cylinder. Some of the tools, the capper as well. Left, speaking of 1911s, oh my gosh, are you sick of hearing about them yet? I'm not. This is a beautiful factory engraved Colt, purchased and presented by Black Jack Pershing, the US General of the Armies, and he presented it to the President of Venezuela. Like, so now we have all the high condition you know, original condition 1911s that are just beautiful. Here's some little history to it as well. Like just, you know, as if North American Arms number one wasn't enough, as if the Singer wasn't enough. There's another one. Let's go back a little further. How about some older iconic US military actions? How about the finest known B Company Mark Colt Walker? Look at that, it's an estimate of 350 to 550,000. That would be pretty consistent with some of the other Walkers that we've sold in this condition range. Up top, there's a beautiful, my goodness, 7172 open top, formerly the William Lott collection, as you can see on the side. And look at the wood on that. Look at the finish, even where the frame joins the barrel, where the frame joins the back strap. There is just so much original blue on there. You can see case hardening there by the recoil shield. Beautiful, beautiful piece. Richard's conversion underneath it. I mean, if you love old percussion Colts, you're in the right place. Let's take a look at one more on day three and we'll wrap it up. A pair, and this is a pair of pistols that does have their own video. We'll try to shade a little. We got the sun coming right in on it. This is a pair of just exhibition quality in every sense of the word, Gastein Renette pistols. They were made for Emperor Franz Joseph of Austria. Not only that, they were exhibited at the Exposition Universelle in Paris, 1855. They have this beautiful grapevine foliage motif. So there's a lot of vines on there. Of course, the grapes, of course, the leaves, covering a lot of it. And this is not uncommon that we've seen on Gastein Renettes before. The vines on the top, you can see, almost form these like Gothic arches that extend down the barrel. We have a video on these as well. They appear in one of our videos. And as Seth points out in that video, these aren't just lines. If you come here in person, or maybe if you go on our website and see some of the closer details, those are actual vines. They have all the, you know, I don't want to say bark on a vine, but all those little variations, all the little striations that you would expect on a grapevine, not just down at the barrel too, but also in these carved ebony handles. Do you know how hard ebony is to carve? I don't. I've never carved it, but based on how hard of a wood, how dense of wood ebony is, not only is the carving in itself difficult and a show of expertise, but to be able to do it in such a hard wood, it's just, it's a little unfathomable, a little unfathomable. And gang, that does it. I hope you liked walking around. I hope you liked seeing the sale of the century. There's so much to see. I just want to come back here and look at it all. I hope you enjoyed what you saw. I hope if you can, you will join us. Again, it's preview day all day. We are open to the public. Just please call us first so we can make accommodations for you. 4th, 5th, and 6th, not only is the sale open to the public, you can do live bidding via telephone. You can do live bidding via React Live. That's our online streaming platform. Or you can just place sealed bids on our website. That's rockislandauction.com. Thanks for watching, everybody. I hope you found the sale as impressive as we do. I hope we did it justice in this video and all the others. If you haven't yet, please give those a subscribe. Check them out. You probably see a few more guns that you enjoy. Thanks for watching, everybody. Enjoy the auction. Good luck on your bids. Until next time, keep your powder dry.